Again, I want to welcome everyone here today, and I want to thank all our volunteers. Yesterday, we put on a huge Easter event for the community. It was awesome. God gave us great weather, and if you volunteer, just lift your hand. Let's give those guys an applause. We had cars parked out on the lawn and all over the place. We just had a great time. A lot of kids, a lot of good pictures, and good memories, and wholesome, family memories together. But also, just continuing to reach out to our community and say, hey, we love you, we care about you, and we love you, I love you, and we're glad to be here together celebrating the resurrection of our Lord and Savior. We have a little special here for you to enjoy, and then I'm going to come and share some words of encouragement to us today.
Faces of some of them being
What Jesus has done for us. And I got the text, or the, yeah, the text at like 12:45 or something. And so I listened to it right away, and as I began to listen to it, I recognized the song. We've actually done the song here. I love it. And as I was listening to it, how much God loves me, what Jesus did for me, I just kind of snuck away into my bedroom and knelt down at the bed, because I was thinking about, during that time, Jesus was on the cross. And I think more than ever before this year, I was mindful of the timeline. And on Good Friday, I didn't have a lot to do. It was a day off for me. But I was aware the whole day of just the process of what was happening on that day and what Jesus had done for me. And I want to share with you this morning three phrases that I hope really encourage you in your faith. But I want to preach the gospel to start. Because the gospel is good news. And in this church, we believe in preaching the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, what he has done for us, so that we can fully appreciate the resurrection. And we're going to get to the resurrection today, but to start with, I just want to share a little bit about what Jesus did for us. And my title today of the message is, The Gospel is a Matter of Life and Death and Life. All right? It's a matter of life and death. And life. It'll make sense when I get into it a little bit. But the first phrase I want to look at out of three is, Jesus died that I might live. Would you say that with me? Jesus died that I might live. So the Bible teaches us, the gospel teaches us, that sin, when we sin, that we've all sinned, as we read in Isaiah chapter 53, it says, you know, we all like sheep have gone astray, we've all sinned, we've all taken our own route, we've all gone our own independent way from God. How many of you can agree with me on that, okay? Just read someone next to you, they didn't raise their hand, say, oh, that's... But the Bible says we've all sinned, so we're not kidding ourselves. We can't kid ourselves on that. But the sin, what it did is it separated us from God. The easiest analogy I have for that is I always like to think about things that use electricity. And if you take something that uses electricity, like a refrigerator, and you unplug it from its life source, it's dead. It still looks like a refrigerator. You know, you still might put food in it, but it's not going to work because it's cut off from its life source. And so the Bible says that when we sin, that sin entered the world, we actually, our spirit died. We were cut off from the life source. Now, almost everybody knows the story of Adam and Eve. And so that's in the very first couple of chapters of the Bible. And God told them, listen, you got everything you need, everything you want, it's all yours except one tree. Don't eat of that tree, the knowledge of good and evil, because if you eat of it, you will die. Basically, that means you're going to choose not to follow me, you're going to choose not to listen to me, you're going to choose rebellion, you're going to choose your own way. How many of you are glad, think about this, that God did not make you to be a robot, but he gave you free choice? Now, love requires a free will. It just requires a free will. And God loves us, and He wanted us to love Him, to worship Him. So He gave us everything except one thing, and so then Adam and Eve chose that one thing eventually. And when they ate of that, this is a very interesting story, if you've ever read it, they didn't die. I mean, they're still walking around, they're still talking, they're still breathing. Something cataclysmic happened, but they're still alive. But what happened is, as we read through the rest of the story, as we understand the scriptures in hindsight, what died was their spirit, right? Their spirit, not their physical being. Now, here's what the Bible tells us, that we are made in the image of God. God is spirit, so you are spirit. This body you live in can change. It can wear out. We can compare ourselves with our bodies and our looks and stuff, but that's not who you are. Some of you are like, woo!
Yeah,
alright, you know? Some of you are like, oh man, you know, I'm working so hard. That's not you. This is not you. You are a spirit. You have a body, alright? You live in a body for temporary. And if you are a spirit, you have a soul, you have feelings, you have an intellect, you have emotions, but you are a spirit. The Bible says sin separated us from God and killed our spirit. Who we really were died. And so we need to be reconciled to God. We need to be, as Jesus put it, born again. So He said this to a guy named Nicodemus. And Nicodemus was a religious, you know, person. He knew the scriptures. But he was scratching his head when Jesus said he had to be born again. He said, what are you talking about? Yeah, I have to go back to my mom's. Like, are you? What? That doesn't make any sense at all. Come out of my mom again, you know? So Jesus went on to say, no, what I'm talking about is you need to be born again of your spirit. You need to be reconciled to God. And the barrier between you and coming alive to God is sin. And the Bible teaches us that the only way for sin to be paid for is through bloodshed. Okay? So for thousands of years, the nation of Israel, the people of Israel, sacrificed animals. And that bloodshed would temporarily appease their sin or cover their sin. But every time they sinned, they had to shed some more blood. But it was not a permanent solution. But the prophets and the scriptures pointed to a day when there would be a Messiah, the anointed one, the sent one, the Christ, who would come and who would wipe away or take away our sins forever. And so that is Christ. And so He is the one, as I mentioned during communion, whose blood was shed on your behalf once and for all. A permanent solution to our sin issue, so that all who would place their faith in Him would be forgiven permanently of all their sin. Okay, He's the only one who qualified to pay that debt. Because He's the only one who came without sin. He remained and lived without sin. So He did not owe the debt of sin. And so He chose to give His life and to pay your debt and my debt for my sin, for your sin. Isn't that awesome? That's why it's called gospel. Gospel means, anybody know two words? Good news. That means good news. Good news. He came. He paid the debt. That's what this is all about. Man, these girls did an awesome job with this. So cool. And so He's the only one qualified, and He chose to do this. Now, if you ever want to share the good news with someone, you know, the most famous scripture in the Bible is John 3:16. But I would encourage you to read John 3:16 and verse 17 and verse 18. If you ever want to share the story of God, this is the most succinct and powerful way to share what God has done for us. So you may know this scripture. It goes like this. God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever would believe in Him would not perish, but have everlasting life. So that's verse 16. Now verse 17 says, God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through Him. This is good news. Okay? He did not send His Son into the world to preach at you, to say, oh, you dirty, lousy, low life, you know, look at all the things you're doing wrong. He didn't say, God did not come to condemn us. He came to save us. Okay? I'm reminded of a story in the Bible when a woman was caught in adultery, and these religious leaders brought her to Jesus, embarrassing her, kind of like almost like manhandled her and tossed her in front of Jesus, and they had stones in their hands, and they said to Jesus, teacher, the law says that if someone's caught in adultery, they should be stoned to death. What do you say? I mean, they're just trying to trick Jesus or try to get him in trouble, because they didn't have the power to actually kill someone at that time. They were under Roman law. They weren't under Jewish law. But they were trying to get him in trouble, and they brought this woman to them. And by the way, I wonder who the guy was. So they bring this woman there. And Jesus says this to the woman, or he says this to the crowd, who's ready to stone her, to kill her, to condemn her. And he says, okay, he who is without sin, be the first to cast your stone. He says, from the oldest to the youngest, they began to drop their stones. The old ones, because we know. We didn't think it's fun to know. We screwed up. And from the oldest to the youngest, every last one of them dropped their stones and walked away. Now here's the power of the story. And this is why I brought this up. In John 3:16, Jesus said this. God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. He was talking about himself. He's there in front of the woman. He looks up to her. He says, woman, are there none here to condemn you? And she said, no, Lord. Now, he was without sin. Jesus could have thrown a stone. This is what he said to her. Then neither do I. I don't condemn you either. Go and leave your life as sin. Now here's the gospel. Here's the good news. Jesus says, I forgive you. I accept you. Now be changed. But most people think this. They think, I've got to get changed. I got to get my act together. I've got to clean myself up. I've got to earn, I've got to, so that I can come to God. And then maybe God will love me and accept me and forgive me. Guess what? It never says that in the scriptures. Just the opposite. This is good news. Because if it wasn't that way, none of us would make it. We'd all be in a big trouble. You hear me? If it was up to me to clean my act up, to make myself good enough to receive God's love, I'm gone. But that's not what the gospel is. The gospel said, as Jesus, kind of exemplified to this woman, he said, I don't condemn you, but now go and be changed. When we come to the love of God and forgiveness of God, it's that forgiveness of God that causes us to have the power to change. God loves you. That's the good news. God loves me. He loves me. He accepts me. He forgives me. And in that forgiveness, I am empowered and I am encouraged to change and become like him through his power in me. So that's the good news. That's the gospel. We call this salvation. What are you saved from? You're saved from your sin. Your sin separated you from God. You need to get back to God. You need your life source. Your spirit is dead. You need to be reborn. How do you do that? That someone would pay this debt of your sin, Jesus, and you accept what he did for you by faith and say, thank you, Jesus. I receive the gift of forgiveness. And the Bible says you are born again. The Bible says if you confess with your mouth, Jesus is Lord. You believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, that he's alive, that he is resurrected, then you will be saved. How many of you believe God raised him from the dead? Yeah. All right, because he lives, you live also. I live also by faith in him. And that's what we're going to talk about the rest of our time together. So the first phrase is I wanted to drive home. Jesus died that I might live. The second phrase I want to share with you is that Jesus lives. Because he's living, now I need to learn how to die. Okay, this is kind of a paradox of the gospel. Before I get into that, I want to read just a couple other verses for you. Hebrews 9:26 says, he, talking about Jesus, has appeared once for all at the culmination of the ages to do away with sin by the sacrifice of himself. All right, say that with me. To do away with sin. He came to do away with sin. That's awesome. That's awesome. Because I was a captive to sin. Before I knew Jesus, I was a captive to sin. I was a slave to sin. I had no power because I had, I had surrendered that power and I was serving sin. But through Christ, he sets free from the power of sin. Okay? Doesn't mean you're perfect. Doesn't mean you don't have mistakes. But does mean that now you can be controlled by the Spirit of God instead of sin. And that's awesome. The other verse I want to read for you is 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 21 to 22. It says, for since death came through a man, and that's talking about the story of Adam and Eve, death came through, sin entered through Adam. says the resurrection of the dead comes also through a man, which is Jesus. So the Bible says, for as in Adam all died, so in Christ all shall live. All shall live. And so in Christ, we can come alive. We are born again. So Christ died so that I can be made alive. My spirit can be born again. Okay, now, once our spirit is born again, now I need to learn how to give my life away, to die to myself. So when I say now I, Jesus lives so I can die, I'm talking about now I am dying to self. My will, myself, my way. That is the very essence of salvation. The essence of salvation says I have veered away from God, I've done things my way, and I've cut myself off from life, and now I'm dead. I need to turn from doing life my way. I need to return to God, receive forgiveness, be plugged back into His life source, His love, His wisdom for my life. And by doing that, I'm dying to my old man, dying to my old self. And I'm reborn in Him and living for Him. So the resurrection of Jesus is the reason why we're here today. Okay? If Jesus hadn't died and raised and was raised to life, I wouldn't be here today. Alright? This whole thing called Christianity would be a dead religion. But because He was raised from the dead, we serve a living God. Amen. Who is present right now in you and in I. We feel His presence. He's alive. He's coming again. We have a living hope. We have a living Savior. He is the hope of the world. And all who don't have a relationship with Him, all right, He is tarrying, or He's waiting for more people to come to know and place their faith in Him as Lord and Savior. Why? Because God didn't send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through Him. So John 3:18, the last verse of that little passage, says this: for everyone who doesn't believe in the Son stands condemned already because he hasn't believed in God's one and only Son. So here's the gospel. The gospel says this: God came to save us. He loves us. He didn't come to condemn us. However, we stand condemned already if we don't turn and receive life through Him. Does that make sense? We're already condemned. God is coming to save us. God isn't coming to condemn us. We're already dead. He's coming to bring us back to life. Amen. And so that's why maybe sometimes we use the word lost. Maybe the lost will be found. The dead will be made alive again. It's just words that we're trying to describe this process that we need to place our faith in Jesus Christ. All right, let's look at Jesus lives that I might die, okay? Now, the power of the resurrection is what gives me and you the power to lay our lives down. How, you know, if Jesus wasn't alive, let's say he wasn't raised from the dead, then this religion, this Christianity thing probably would have never happened. There would have been nothing really to build on, okay? And so a person who doesn't believe in the resurrection of Jesus Christ might have this view of life. Well, this is all there is. If this is all there isn't any life after that. There isn't any living hope. There isn't a God who loves me and is for me. And this is all there is. Then how many of you think we would just, okay, let me get all I can get. Right? Let me live this life to the fullest. Let me just live as much as I can get out of this life. And honestly, some people have that view of life. That's their view. So their goal is just to get as much happiness or as much, you know, fullness as they can get, because this is all they have. However, let's think about the opposite. If Jesus was raised from the dead, all right, and everything he said was true, and that your life now is secure, you have eternity all set, he's got your eternity wrapped up in his hands, then that truth, if I believe in that, empowers me to lay my life down for him. There's a famous missionary, I don't know if you've ever heard his name, but he died trying to reach an unreached people group it was in a remote part of the world. It was tribal people. He died, they actually killed him while he was trying to reach them. He was with them for a while, living with them, trying to reach them. The awesome part of the story is that his team and his wife his widow, came back and continued his work in spite of the fact that they killed him and the whole tribe that came to the Lord later. His name, I just lost his name. Yeah, Jim Elliot.
No.
Is that right? Yeah. Sorry, anyway, blank it. He said this, and in his journals they found this quote became famous, but it's so inspirational. He said, "He is no fool who gives what he cannot keep, his life, to gain what he cannot lose, eternity."
Thank you, Lord.
He is no fool, she is no fool, the person who gives what you can't keep, your life, you can't keep it, you can't add to it, you're not in control of it. You're not a fool by giving your life away to gain something you cannot lose, which is eternity.
Yeah.
And that is the call of a Christian. That is the invitation of Christ. He says, "I came to save you, to give you life, to give your spirit back, to reconnect with God. Now that you're alive, now die. Give your life away. Give your life away. You're alive. You're secure. You've got all eternity with me. You got everything you ever needed, everything you'll ever want. You've got it in me. Now give it away. Give it away." And that's the thing that I'm calling, that I'm saying is what we're trying to learn how to die. My whole life I've been trying to learn how to die better. This is a hard thing. I mean, every single time I had a child, I had five kids. The first child, I could not believe how selfish I was. When child number one came along, I'm like, "Oh, I gotta do this, and I gotta do that." I'm like, "Wow, I didn't realize how self-centered I was." I thought, okay, God did a really good work in my life when child number two came along. And I had to die a little bit more. And child number three, each one. And then, and just getting married itself was a process of learning how to die. Right? Got an amen over there. All right. So, we all deal with self-centeredness, but God is teaching us how to lay our life down and follow his footsteps. Here's some implications of the resurrection I want to identify for you real quick before we do our third phrase, okay? Now, these are the implications of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. First of all, when Jesus was raised from the dead, it proved that he is the Son of God, he is the Messiah, he is the one that was promised in the prophets and throughout the scriptures that would come to set us free from our sins. The resurrection proved that he is the one. Nobody else was raised from the dead like that. Okay? Jesus himself raised three people from the dead, but then they died again. Okay? Jesus was raised to life, and he did not die again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated right now at the right hand of God, and he's interceding for you. He's interceding for me. And he's waiting for us, his children, to finish the work he began by subduing the enemies, and one day he will return to a loud trumpet call and a shout of heaven, and he's going to come back with all who have died in Christ with him, gloriously dressed in white, in victory. He's going to come and set the score straight. And we who are left will meet him in the air. Right? That's the promise. That's the loving hope that we have. So he's alive. He's alive. He is resurrected. He's alive. So he proved that he is the Messiah. He is the Son of God. The second thing that his resurrection proves is that God accepted the sacrifice for our sins. When he was raised to life, that proved that God, that his sacrifice on our behalf was accepted by God, and then he raised his son to life. That's a big deal for you and for me. Okay? That validated the forgiveness of our sins. Alright, the third thing that the resurrection did is it validated that all that Jesus said and taught was true. He taught his disciples a lot about the stuff that was going to happen. Several times he talked with them. One time Peter came up and said, No, "No, Lord, you're not going to die. No, we're not doing that." And then he turned to Peter, which is one of his strongest disciples at the time. And what did he say to him? He said, "Get behind me, Satan." I mean, you said that to a friend. I wouldn't recommend that. Okay? But he said, "Get behind me, Satan." No, he wasn't Satan, but what he was saying was, your mind right now is on the things of this world. Just satanic. Your mind is not on the things of God. Because what I'm telling you is the plan and purpose of God. And if Peter had his way, you and I, and Peter himself, would not be forgiven of our sins. Okay? So, Jesus came and he told his disciples these things ahead of time, and he said this, he said this, I have told you now before it happens, so that when it does happen, you will believe. You will believe. And if he was right about his death and resurrection, how many of you believe he was right about everything else he said? Okay, so my life is staked on these words, this book. It's not really a book. It is the Word of God. My life is built on this, and did you know that there's over 7,000 promises of God for you in this book? Over 7,000 promises. And the Bible says every single one of them is already a big yes in Christ. And you and I have the task to say amen. In other words, we have to learn what the promise is, and we have to agree with God in our heart. Faith arises, and we say, yes, amen. Thank you, Lord. And then that promise begins to change our lives. You know what I'm saying? We talk about that a lot in our church, about how to access the promises of God. It's always through faith and believing. Okay, the fourth implication is this. And this is the one that we're celebrating here today, probably the most. Is he was the first fruits. He was the first fruits of the resurrection, which means this. All who place their faith in him will also be resurrected unto life. Can I get a big amen on that one?
Yeah.
Amen. So, we're going to get a brand new body. This is going to be awesome. But now, you are a spirit, so your faith in him, your spirit's born again, you're saved. But your body is kind of, subtly deteriorating. Breaking down. But the Bible says you will be given a new body fit for eternity without limits. You'll be able to eat, so you can eat, okay? That's good, right? You want to eat? You'll be able to eat, not gain weight. That'd be awesome. I say you'll be able to eat because we see Jesus in his glorified body. He came back after he rose from the dead. He came back and he appeared over the course of 40 different days. Not 40 days, but over the course of 40 days. He made appearances. One time, the Bible says, he appeared over 500 people at once. So there's all kinds of witnesses to see the resurrected body of Jesus. But one of the things he did, one time he appeared on the shore with his disciples. They came in and they ate fish together. So he ate fish in his resurrected body. So we get to eat. All right, that's good. Now the other thing I want to share with you just inspires me is Jesus, in his resurrected body, he still bears the scars of his love towards you. And one day when you see him face to face, which you'll be able to do that, when you see him, you will see the scars on his body that he bore for you. That will be an eternal testimony of God's love for you and for me. Isn't that amazing? So in his resurrected body, he still bears the scars for you and for me as an eternal reminder of God's love for us. That's pretty awesome. And so we're going to be given new bodies. It's going to be great. We're going to be given new bodies. Some of us, and I want to share this with you too, about the thief on the cross. You remember the cross, and then there was two thieves there, and they had an argument, kind of. The one thief was probably cursing at Jesus, ridiculing him like the other, maybe some of the soldiers, some spectators, some of the religious people, and he probably just jumped on the bandwagon. Yeah, save yourself, come on down, let me see a miracle. And they were mocking him. I don't know what he was saying, cursing at him or something. The other thief got mad. I think the other thief started cussing the other one out. I'm not going to cuss, okay? But he might have said, shut up. You know, this man, he didn't do anything wrong. You and I, we deserve to be up here. I mean, you know, we're scoundrels. We made some big mistakes. This guy hasn't done anything wrong. Leave him alone. Leave him alone. See, you know, just like one thief to another, he knows how to, you know, talk. So he got to shut up or something. But then he turned to Jesus, this other thief. He turned to Jesus. And you probably know the story, but he said to him, he said, Lord, when you come into your kingdom, please remember me. Please remember me. Now think about this guy on the cross. I don't know anything about him. But what I do know is he didn't pray the sinner's prayer. He didn't have a pastor there say, bow your heads, pray after me, and repeat after me. Jesus, thank you, love me, give me my sins. He didn't do that. What did he do? He just said, Lord, remember me. And what did Jesus say? He said, man, if we could just get you down from there and get you baptized. Can anybody help us out here? No. He didn't say that. He didn't say that. He didn't have all these religious requirements. What the man did on the cross, the thief, is he placed his faith in Jesus. He didn't know how to say it. He's a thief. He'd never been to church or seen God. He didn't hear anybody saying these prayers before. They didn't have a sinner's prayer invented yet. You know what I'm saying? He said, Lord, remember me. And Jesus turned to him and said this. It's awesome. He says, today, be with me in paradise. Lord, thank you. You know, for those of us who've lost loved ones in the faith, the Bible says literally that we don't even die. You know, it looks like we die, our body stops, and we call that death. I understand that, but you're a spirit. You're spirits. The Bible says that there isn't another death. What we do is we go from this life into life. We go immediately into paradise with Jesus. So our loved ones are there, and the Bible calls them part of the cloud of witnesses, cheering us on. From the vantage point of eternity, they are screaming at us. Go for it.
Come on.
Give your life to the Lord. Lay it down. Make something of it. Give trust in Him. They're like, you won't believe it. It's worth it. Give all you got. Just lay your life down. Trust Him. Follow Him. Whoa! They're just like, they're probably like more focused on Jesus than they are us. But you know what I'm saying? They are a cloud of witnesses. And the Bible does say they are cheering us on. And because we're in the presence of God. Isn't that awesome? And if your body wears out before Jesus returns, and you die, according to our definition here on earth, you know, if you die that day, you will go immediately into the presence of God. That's awesome. I don't know if you get your resurrected. I don't think you get your resurrected body yet, but somehow you're in the presence of God. When Christ comes back, we're all going to be transformed. But I don't know. I could be wrong. I don't know. It's a mystery. Okay, but we're all going to get those two Bibles. But we're heaven. Okay? Isn't that great? Isn't that awesome? Because He lives, you can live. Okay? Because He died, you can live. Now He lives in us, we need to learn how to die to ourselves and let Him live in us and through us. And here's my third phrase that I want to challenge you with as I close with this, is that I now, as I die to myself, as I offer my life to God, that's when I really come alive. That's when I really come alive. So that's why I said the gospel, the title of this message, the gospel is a matter of life and death. And life. You need to get light so that you can die, so that you can live. Okay? Anybody who's ever evaluated their lives significantly, anybody who thinks about their life and thinks about what matters the most, every one of us, we come to the same conclusion. Life only takes on real meaning and real value when we give it away. We know that. When we live it for ourselves, we know it's an empty lifestyle. We know it's not producing anything. It's not making a difference anywhere. But when we give our life away, when we give our energy away, our heart away, resources to good causes, to people, the kingdom, we know that brings to us true meaning. And we come alive. Now this is the deal. God created you with a great plan in mind. He calls you to partner with Him, His Spirit in you, to partner with Him, to love people, which is the greatest thing you can do on the earth. To love God, to love people. And that's what God has hotwired you for. And when you begin to die to yourself, and I begin to die to myself, I begin to lay my life down in all the different ways that looks like, I begin to come alive. Jesus put it this way. If you try to save your life, if you try to live a self-centered life, you try to preserve life for yourself, you're going to lose it. You're going to lose the whole meaning of life. Your life is going to shrink to nothingness. But if you lose your life, if you give it away for the gospel's sake, for me, for the kingdom, by loving God and loving people, if you lay it down, if you give it away, you're going to find it. You're going to find true life in me. Okay? So remember, when you lay your life down, when you're giving your life away, when you're dying yourself and you're giving your life away, you are not losing anything. You are gaining everything. You are not crazy for loving people who don't love you. for sacrificing for others. You're not crazy for giving your life away. You are saved. All right? You see the big picture. You see, because of the resurrection of Christ, now you can't lose anything. You're laying your life down because God has empowered you to do that with His Spirit. It's an awesome journey, isn't it?
Yes.
To be able to do that. And so, in the end, we are going to come alive. I'm going to share this with you as 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 14 to 49. It says, if there is a natural body, this thing right here, there's also a spiritual body. So it is written, the first man, Adam, became a living being. The last Adam, which is Jesus, a life-giving spirit. The spiritual did not come first, but the natural, and after that, the spiritual. The first man, Adam, was of the dust of the earth. The second man, Jesus, is of heaven. As was the earthly man, so are those who are of the earth. And as is the heavenly man, so also are those who are of heaven. And just as we have borne the image of the earthly man, so shall we bear the image of the heavenly man. Okay, so we have been made of the dirt, of the dust. We bear the image of this mortal life, you know, through Adam. But you will also bear the image of the heavenly man with an eternal body, with an eternal life in him. Isn't that exciting?
Yeah.
There's a natural first, then a spiritual. And so Paul wants to do that. He desires to do that. So in Philippians chapter 3, he says, I want to know Christ. I can see him like just being like super passionate about like, I want to know Christ. I want to know him. And he says, yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. And so here's the paradox of the gospel, okay? If you're here this morning and you haven't made Jesus the Lord of your life, I'm going to be very blunt with you. Here's the crazy invitation I have to give you. Listen to this. It doesn't make sense, okay? But I'm going to say what it is. Here's the deal. You're a walking dead person. Okay? Your spirit is dead. You need to be reconciled to God. You need to be born. You need to come alive. So the invitation of the cross is, Jesus says, I died for you. I love you. Come to me. I will give you life. Okay, I like that part. Then, as soon as you do that, then he says, now I want you to die. Okay? And if you trust me and you die, now I'm talking about dying to self, dying to independence, dying to my personal rights, offering my whole life into God's hands. Jesus says, follow me. Follow me. As you follow me, if you do this, though, now that you're alive, now if you offer your life to me, you die to self, you're going to really come alive. Okay? That's the deal. That's the deal. And so you really experience more and more of that life that God has for you, and I do too, as we learn, thinking about life and ways, to learn to lay it down. That's the journey. Now, what does laying your life down look like? I mean, for a guy, it might be changing a diaper. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's a lot of times I sit on the couch and smell the diaper and say, hey, hey. And once in a while, once in a while, I would die to myself, get off the couch, and change the diaper. Right? What does it look like for you to die to yourself? I mean, I'm not talking about you carelessly letting people abuse you, taking advantage of you. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about being led by the Spirit of God and being willing to just follow His leading in your life, because we have all been given gifts, talents. We all had a calling. We all have people that God has designed for us to impact with His love, His presence. His presence is in us. We are the temple of the Holy Spirit. God doesn't want people to experience a better you. God wants people to experience Him through you. And so a surrendered life looks different for all of us because we're just following what God is calling us to do. But it's a selfless life. It's a selfless life. It's following God. It's following His Spirit. Does that make sense to you? I mean, there's no other way to define it because it's one moment at a time, following what God is calling us to do. But I want to share this final scripture with you as we close. Okay? John 11:25. Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. This is the power of the resurrection. You are alive because Jesus is alive. You are called to follow him by laying your life down. And if you do that, if you follow him, the greater degree to which you are laying your life down, the greater life you are going to experience in heaven. And when we die physically, we are promised an eternity in heaven with our Lord and Savior. We go immediately into his presence. And how many of you have already accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior? How many of you have done that? Well, I celebrate with you, Mr., Mrs., young person. You are in the group of God. You're in the group of God. Even when you try to let go, God still got you. I don't know if you've ever had a little one you're crossing the parking lot with, and you say, hold my hand, and they're holding your hand, and all of a sudden they go, bing, like this. What are you doing? You're squeezing a little tighter. Right? You don't let go. You don't let go. I'm so encouraged by the love of God. He loves us. He didn't come to condemn us. He came to save us. So we need to place our faith in him and continue to lay our life down. That we might be filled with what we're full. Jesus said, I came that you might have life and have it abundant. Have it abundant. And so my prayer is that God would use you and your life mightily as you follow him, as you lay it down with him. You will be enriched and blessed, but there are going to be people's lives that are changed because God does something in you and through you, and it overflows to people around you. You will impact people for eternity. My prayer is that heaven will be more populated because of your life, because of your prayers, because of your sacrifice, because of your love, because of your willingness to lay your life down. Can you get behind that one? Wouldn't it be awesome to get to heaven and say, wow, there's some people that God allowed me to change, and that they're here because God did something in me, and I was willing to let God do something through me. Would you stay with me? I want to invite you to pray a prayer with me today as we close our Easter service. And our worship team's going to come, and then we're going to sing the final song together. And as they're coming, I would like to just invite you this morning. You know, wherever you are in your walk with God, if you haven't accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, today, the Bible says, is the day of salvation. Okay? Today is the day of salvation. Whenever you hear the gospel and the Spirit of God starts to speak to your heart, that is the moment to respond. Right, God? The Bible says, if you hear his voice today, do not harden your heart. Don't harden your heart and resist what God wants to do in your life. If you feel your heart, him talking to your heart today, now is the time to respond to the good news. I went to church for a few years when I was young. I was 5 or 6 years old. I'd go to church, I'd go to Sunday school, I'd walk to the church. And then we moved from Flint to Clio. And then a pastor came to my house. And the first couple of years I went to church as a child, I'd never heard the gospel. I heard Jesus, I learned some songs, I did some crafts, I got glitter on me, and all stuff like that. But I never heard the gospel. And a pastor came to my house, and I was 6 or 7 years old, and he just told me the gospel. He told me that Jesus, lived a sinful life, the Son of God, he came, he died for my sins, that I needed to accept him to be forgiven of my sins. And I, honestly, as a young child, that's why I really love children coming to the Lord in our church. We have children that we baptize. Why? Because I was one of them, and I was seeking God, and I knew there was a God, but I didn't know the gospel. And a pastor told me the gospel, and immediately the lights went on, and I'm like, awesome. And I knelt down right there on that, you guys know the story, green shaggy carpet, my mom and dad's living room, and I prayed a prayer and accepted Christ in my words. Because God spoke to my heart that day when I heard the gospel. God is speaking to your heart today, and the Bible says today's the day of salvation. Open your heart and place your faith. You know what, if you just feel like you've walked away from God, you just are distant from God, or you just want to recommit your life to God, I do this every single day. Every day I wake up, I'm like, Lord, I'm yours. And this is what I do every day, not because I'm afraid I'm not saved, but because every day I need to learn how to let Jesus be Lord of my life. And if you just want to just make a fresh commitment to the Lord, today's a great day, it's Easter, and I died for you, that'd be a great day to do that. And to just renew your faith in him. So would you bow your heads with me, and I'm going to lead us in a prayer. And if you are here this morning, say, Pastor, I'm ready to receive Jesus as my Lord and Savior. If that's you, and if you haven't done that before, or you're not sure where you stand with God, but you're doing that this morning, would you just lift your hand so I can just celebrate the decision? I just want to see your hand to say, I'm proud of you, and celebrate that. So that you just lift your hand up high, say, Pastor, I pray to receive Jesus today as Lord and Savior. And if you're here this morning, say, Pastor, I'm just recommitting my life to God. Today's another day that I choose to serve Him as Lord and Savior. Would you lift your hand too? Thank you. Some hands all over. And I just want to invite you to pray this prayer from your heart. As I kind of lead us, I'll just repeat these words. Okay, after me. Let's say this together. Jesus,
thank you
that you love me. And I believe
that
you lived a sinless life. And that you died on a cross. And you're raised to life.
Purchasing for me
forgiveness of my sins.
And according to your word,
I confess with my mouth
that Jesus,
you're my Lord.
And I receive
your forgiveness
of my sins.
And I offer my life to you.
I ask that you fill me
with your Holy Spirit.
So now I have the power
to live this new life in you.
I thank you,
and I love you,
and I praise you.
In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
We praise you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
I pray for all of us, Lord. I just thank you for this day. I thank you, Lord, for the resurrection power that now continues to reside within us, the same power that raised Christ from the dead, now lives within each and every one of us, to quicken these mortal bodies, to embolden us and empower us to be your witnesses, to have the strength to say no to self, and to say yes to you, to be led by your Spirit. And so, Lord, we pray that today, this week, and in the months ahead, Lord, that you will do a powerful thing in our lives, that you will fill us and overflow through us and change lives, Lord, through your presence in us. We offer ourselves to you, and we thank you, Lord, for your grace that sustains us each and every day. We thank you, Lord, that our salvation was never based on our own merit or effort, and our continued salvation is never based on our performance. It's all based on your love and your grace towards us. And we receive you today, Lord, in your Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Well, as we're standing, let's sing a final song together. It's a great hymn of the church called Victory in Jesus, okay? And if you place your faith in Him, you have victory. So who's got some victory here today? Let's sing this together as we celebrate. Now come back and close us with blessings.
I heard an old story. Our Savior came from glory. How He gave His life on Calvary to save a wretch like me.
Oh,
floods. Let's talk about your baptism. You know, so when we are baptized in Christ, it's a picture of our death, right? He died to the old man, and we are raised to a new life in Him. So when you went down, the Bible says, hey, you were plunged under that water. You've died to the old man, all that old stuff. You've come out as a brand new creation. The old has passed away. And all things are brand new. So let's just do that for us one more time, okay? Sweatshirts in Kenya, but you know, oh, it's winter time. Thank you for clarifying. And some things. So, if you would like to adopt a child, you can take a name, and the instructions are back there, and you can be a blessing to some little girl, you know, on the other side of the world if you'd like to.